was talking earlier about fulfilling dreams, and I think this is really a dream situation to have all these women composers all together in one room. And you know, it's, I found it so very inspiring what I've heard tonight. I'm really happy to be part of this. And thanks, Abby.
I'm so nervous. two sopranos. So the first piece was called Broken Wheel Bop, followed by the poem Waves. The second piece was called Passing Through, dedicated all the many musician friends that passed, you know, the last 6 years. It was hard on me, and I know it was hard on many other people passing through. Afterwards, we did a piece totally free improvised to the poem Colors. Then the next piece, the next composition was, I don't know my title. Minor Pandemonium. And followed by that was Inspiration.
Taylor and David Jolie and trumpet player, the Areopagitica brass trio, they wanted a piece. So this was originally written for those instruments, for bass, trombone, French horn, and trumpet. And I really need something to get me going, so I spend a lot of time on the subway and I see interesting people. And so that was the basis of that. And also just the rhythm of the train was always kind of in the background, the ambient sound of that. And then Double Entendre had asked for a piece, and very quickly, they needed a piece. And the nice thing about it was, because it's very agile, it's actually probably better on the reeds, because some of the fast things on the lower brass instruments don't speak as well. So, probably more than you wanted to know.
No, that's good. I'm curious also about I don't think this microphone. I'm curious about. I know this might sound simplistic, but when you're working with words and lyrics, does the poem inspire the music or vice versa?
Well, in this case, all the music behind the poetry was completely free improvised. So the music was inspired by the poem, and I have to say, Ann and Kevin did an incredible job. They had the poem in front of them, but they stopped when they really needed to, and I never told them to. So wonderful, thank you for being so sensitive, you know? It's just great to write support. I do write lyrics sometimes, which seems to me extremely hard because, you know, you have to fit the words to a form that makes sense, you know, sometimes the other way around. I've done it, I'm not happy with it, I'm not very good at it. That's all I can say.
Didn't sound that way. Okay, do you have a question?
A question?
About the way you approach lyrics and song.
Yeah, this is like a dead
leg.
It's like a prop, it's a prop. You know, it's to me it's very open-ended, you know, how a piece originates. You know, a lot of times it's on a feeling. I've written so much music just taking walks, you know, going by the water, you know, sometimes just meditating. Sometimes something literally just pops in my head. I've got the whole song written by the time I'm home. You know, I'll write it on the subway. You know, I've had a lot of songs like that. And you know, I get inspired. You know, to me, it's like sound is sound. When we're connected on a certain level, we can kind of hear our ancestors. We can cross space and time, you know. And to me, my writing works best when I'm in that place where I can just kind of take in what, you know, just take it in. And when I start imposing myself, it sometimes can be manufactured, kind of. It's not necessarily inspiring. Although it's doing in the bass, it's just that flow, that kind of ongoing water kind of feel, you know, that's what started that. And I've done that piece in so many different ways. And the lyric came, well, I don't know if anybody's left here. I was in this wonderful choir for 3.5 years, gospel choir and others, spiritual and classical. But the music from tonight, a lot of that came from working with that group and just being in this amazing group. And the director was amazing. And so, where am I? So with God as a blessing, You know, it was instrumental for the longest time, but then actually Deborah and I guess she left, Deborah and I had an event that we did a few years ago, and that's when I started putting a lyric to it. And you know, it kind of evolved. And so all those little motifs, just like, that's just what it feels like. You know, I would improvise different rhythmic patterns, and when I did it for Looking Through Trees, right, there was no lyric there, and the rhythms were actually more complex because we had more cross rhythms with the ones on different places. With when I was playing with Ken Yamazaki and Joe Giardullo, but for this, it's when you're, there's a certain settings where you have to make a little bit more straightforward. So this was more straightforward, but the lyric just kind of came with what the motif was. Like, this is what it feels like, you know. And I think Rosi, you probably had the same experience when you're creating a poetic phrase. You know, there's a feeling, there's a kind of arc to what the phrase is, and that just lends itself to the music, what the music's going to be.
The first poem I did, it was the melody that I played on the violin, and I sang, if you didn't notice, I sang a fourth below that melody, the same thing. That came directly from how I speak. So, and I think a lot of composers write with the phrase of the voice, you know. So, yeah.
Also interested in, for instance, Lee, you're a multi-instrumentalist, and your approach to starting to compose. Are you thinking of the other instruments that you're playing with, or you're thinking, or is it centered on the, on what you know, how your skill with that particular instrument?
Right. That's very interesting. I may have never thought about that, but I know, like, the poet is specifically for clarinet. Just the timbre that the clarinet has, and the emotion that I want to put into it. I just know the clarinet just has the timbre that I'm looking for. So lots of times that does play a role in how I write. And then sometimes not. It's the notes will be there, and you know, I'll play it on alto, oh cool. Then I'll play it on soprano, and it's like, oh, I like it here. You know, so yeah.
Just find your voicings.
Right, yeah.
Is there a question that you would like to address?
Yes, I would be curious, I wanted to ask Lee, if you could tell us a little bit about your process with the last composition that you played, Right.
Right. So that was based off of a question, you know, the wavelengths, the relative wavelength between light and sound, and trying to find that. So when I started my research, I found out I'm not the only one who asked that question. So
yes.
I didn't. So I'm glad that I'm not going crazy. It was getting really intense because then it started talking about intervals, and the color started changing with intervals. So I was like, let me just keep it from A to A and research that. And then I took the color wheel and I mashed it up to the circle of force. And then within there, there's just like tritones within a certain note. So I also have another piece called Indigo, which the research was very consistent from all around that Indigo was the A440. So I have a piece that starts off with basically the orchestral tuning note called Indigo. So yeah, it's been a very interesting research on this.
Yeah, I wanted to ask you about that too, because I think a lot of musicians think in those terms but never go into depth with the research. But my question is, do you visualize colors when you work with?
You know what, I don't. And I think that's what sparked the science behind it for me.
Oh.
Because I really enjoyed science.
Yeah.
And you know, not so much math. I don't mind it, but I really enjoy science, so I decided to just approach it from a scientific, research.
Yeah.
That was a great question, thank you.
That's very beautiful.
Thank you.
Anybody else would like to address? Okay, thank you so much. I mean, is there anything else that you would like to say, or thank you?
Well, I just want to,
And thank you, Abby.
It's a great pleasure.
Yeah. You know, people don't realize what goes into creating an event like this. It takes a lot of time, a lot of really care. Abby puts a lot of joy and laughter into it. If you want to hear the story behind the videotape that we made, it's pretty funny. And I really do appreciate being in the room with so many different kinds of composers. Some of the artists for next week are here.
Please hold on to
stand up if you're really in the concert for next week. Are they still here? Diane Moser was here.
Sacco
was here. Wasn't Judith here? Sacco. Yeah, all the composers from next week were here, so make sure you come next week. And it's just, to me, it is a rare thing, really, to have this many women who are just wonderful composers together in the same room, such a range. Abby took a lot of care into having a range of kinds of music. And I'm really, really happy to be part of this. Really, thank you, and thank you guys.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
It's really a question about the technical way of, I hear how you conceptualize what you're going to write, but to actually write it, I mean, people write in really different ways now. I mean, you generate something on a computer, or you said you composed on the saxophone. Do you compose with piano? Do you compose with computer? Do you get out the pencil? What is the actual process that each of you use?
I would usually get a harmonic idea on the piano, and then melody and things will come out of that. So, and I'll write it down on the paper, and then I'll put it on the computer.
Pen and paper, and very often it's just, a fraction of an idea in my head. Sometimes not even a melody, just a concept. And then I play around with that concept in the melody forms, and I put it on my violin. And once I have something, I go to the piano and try to find chords that go along with the melody. That's basically it. And my partner is a composer, and he helps me sometimes to put it in the computer. I do not have the patience to do that.
And like I said, as far as how I do my, but usually I start with rhythm. I feel like, rhythm is a really huge part in just, the first metronome basically was the heartbeat. So rhythm is kind of like the most organic part, I think, sometimes. So rhythm usually comes to my head first, and then I'll put something with the rhythm, or maybe I'll put a note on the rhythm. I don't know, sometimes it's just how I feel that day, too.
Speak
to that?
Oh. Yeah. A lot of my music is very rhythmic, and I spend a lot of time just working out what the rhythm is, playing it on the piano, singing it. Anybody who's seen me in the neighborhood, I'm always singing and moving and, I'm dancing as I'm just going to the grocery store and taking a walk in the park. That's how I get the rhythms. I have to feel it in my body. And my editor, he left, but he was here tonight. I mean, he will tell you that I change my mind all the time when every time I go to him. But you change your mind. It's like, that's because I'm working it out. And it feels right. It needs to be 5 pounds. It needs to be 5.5 pounds. It needs to go 3 times, not 2 times. Because there's a natural order of rhythm that is much more expansive
and complex that we are able to put in a 4-4 bar. The rhythm has so many different things, and to be able to feel rhythm on that deep level, you have to spend a lot of time with the rhythm. And so it's a long time before I get to the score, to the written score, before I start. You know, I have to feel that first, and then it goes to the score.
It doesn't have to be 4-4.
That's correct.